morning, I'd like you to take your Bibles and turn with us to John chapter number 4. John chapter number 4. Very simple message this morning. A message that probably a lot of people aren't familiar with. One look at really one of the longest recorded dialogues that Jesus had with an individual person. And it's a story of the account of a woman at the well. And he come down and met with the woman. He come down and talked to the woman, and we'll break the details down. But the message that he had was, you can drink the water that you come to draw, but it will only temporarily satisfy you. But if you will drink the living water that I can offer you, you can have eternal life. And we know that she came to know Christ as her Savior, and she went forward. That's the gist of the story that we're looking at today. We will have fairly a long passage. We can get the right microphone turned on here. Take my step back. John chapter number 4, we're going to read the passage. I did say it was one of the longest individual dialects recorded. And we'll start in verse number 1. When therefore the Lord knew how the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself baptized not, but his disciples, he left Judea and departed again into Galilee, and he must needs go through Samaria. Then cometh he to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, to the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being weary with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. And Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. For his disciples were gone away into the city to buy meat. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto them, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am I a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is to thee, saith he, give me to drink. Thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. And the woman saith unto him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well, and drank thereof himself, and his children, and his cattle? Jesus answered and saith unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting. The woman saith unto him, sir, give me not this water, or give me this water, that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. Jesus saith unto her, go, call thy husband, and come hither. And the woman answered and said, I have no husband. And Jesus saith unto her, thou hast well said, I have no husband. For thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou hast is not thy husband, and that sayest thou truly. The woman said unto him, sir, I perceive thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that Jerusalem is a place where men ought to worship. Jesus saith unto her, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet in Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship, ye know not why. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. The woman saith unto him, I know that the Messiah is coming, which he called Christ. And when he come, he will tell us all things. And Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. And upon this came his disciples, and marveled that he talked with the woman. Yet no man said, what seekest thou? Or why talkest thou with her? The woman then left her water pot and went her way into the city and saith to the men, come see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? Then they went out of the city and came unto him. And in the meeting, while his disciples prayed him, saying, Master, eat. But he said unto them, I have need to eat that ye know not of. Therefore said the disciples one to another, hath any man brought him aught to eat? And Jesus saith unto them, My meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. Say not ye, you're 4 months and the coming of the harvest. Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are already ripe to harvest. And he that reapeth receiveth wages and gathereth fruit into life eternal, that both he soweth and that he reapeth may rejoice together. And herein is that same truth. One soweth and another reapeth. I sent you to reap that whereon you bestowed no labor. Other men labor, and ye are entered into their labor. And many of the Samaritans of that city believed on him for the sayings of the woman, which testified, he told me all that ever I did. So when the Samaritans were coming to him, they besought him that he would tarry with them, and he abode there 2 days. And many more believed because of his own word. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we do thank you for the day. We thank you for everything that you've given us. God, I just pray that you be with us in the next few moments, that you'll just allow your message, your word to be manifest. For me, Lord, to each individual heart, I thank you for the ways you've spoken to me in preparation for this message. And God, I just pray that you'll just allow each one of us to have a changed life today. God, if there be any in your house and my husband are saved, Lord, I know there will be a clear presentation of the gospel. I just pray that you convict them, to draw them unto you, that you allow them to see not only the need of their salvation, but you allow them to see how great you really are, how much you love us, that you came and you died, that you shed your blood on the cross for each and every one of us. You made the salvation free. God, I pray that you just allow them to receive it, for it's eternal and too late. God, I pray that you be with all the ministries of this church, be with each individual person, be with all the requests, and thank you for all the gifts. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. The woman at the well. Now Jesus is on his journey, and Jesus comes to the well. The first thing I want us to look at is the specific encounter. And there's some things that we can take out of this, verse 7 and 9. The Samaritan woman came to draw water. Jesus said unto her, will you give me a drink? And then she said back to him, but you're a Jew and I'm a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? You see, from the Jewish perspective, from the laws of man, the laws of culture that were taking place in that day, there was no reason that Jesus the Jew ought to even be talking to the Samaritan woman. And somebody once said that there was already 3 strikes against the Samaritan woman. And humanly speaking, that would be true. But Jesus, the Son of God, the Savior of the world, you know, there's no strikes against us with him. And Jesus overcome these things, and it's an encounter that we have to be able to take kind of under our belt, so to speak, moving forward, and apply these same principles to our life. You see, first of all, she was a woman. And I know culture has changed, but back then, in public, a Jewish man did not speak to a Jewish woman in public. Often the Jewish man did not even speak to his wife in public. It's just something they didn't do. It's something that was against the culture. And when Jesus' disciples returned, when we got down to about verse 27, verse number 28, we see that they even began to talk among themselves, and they began to think, well, you know, what is Jesus doing talking to this woman? This something right here. Why would he be communicating with this woman? He's a Jew. She's a Samaritan. And the Jewish man just didn't speak to the woman in public. It was against the social custom. And you know, there's a lot of social customs that we still hold on to today. And we know that Jesus lived on this earth without what? Somebody say it, without sin. So is it a sin to break a social custom? Absolutely not. And that's what Jesus was teaching us. And that's what Jesus was helping the people and his disciples to understand in this day. Just because man don't think it's okay for them to go do something, or just because man has got this social custom that limits their communication with one another, I am Jesus, I'm the Son of God, I died for all people, it is okay for you to share the gospel with anybody on the face of this earth. But all we find ourselves so often today in our present day encounters, holding the social customs in front of us. But we don't want to associate with them. We shouldn't be talking to them in public. Why would I do that? People in the church, if they see me talking to this person or that person, they're not going to accept me. That's a problem that the church has today. It's a problem that was present in the day that Jesus walked on the earth and he took the first step forward to break down that barrier. Jesus saw this woman. He was already at the well when she cometh. Jesus, fully man and fully God, he knew she was coming. He was there for a purpose. He was there to have this encounter. And it didn't matter if she was a woman. Jesus was going to speak to her the truth. And Jesus was going to speak to her the gospel of Christ. She was not only a woman, but she was also a Samaritan. And in this day again, we take the cultural context, we take the historical context, and there was a bitter hostility between the Jews and the Samaritans. They did not like each other. They could not get along. They were doing everything short of a declaration of war. They couldn't stand each other. And now this woman of Samaria comes down and Jesus talks to her. But Jesus not only talked to her, Jesus asked her, "Give me a drink. Will you draw me some water for me to drink?" And she replied, "I'm a Samaritan. Who are you to ask me to get you a drink?" You see, the history between the people, they go back a long way. It goes back a real long way. When the Assyrians took Samaria captive, they, for lack of better terms, they deported a lot of the nationals. They kicked them out of their country. They got rid of them. And they replaced them from people from everywhere. You can go back to 2 Kings chapter 17 and see that account. And when they've done that, they opened up people to come in and be a part of them that brought in a lot of other little g gods. They brought in a lot of the false gods. And they brought in a whole bunch of different religions, so to speak, and means of worship. The single worship of God was disappearing. They had replaced it with what they wanted, what man wanted. And even in their religion and even in their worship, they began to distort what had been present. They began to refute anything in the scriptures except the Pentateuch, Genesis through Deuteronomy. They began to not hold any validity or not hold any value to Psalms or the Proverbs or any of the book of prophets or any of the books that were recorded at that time. They were holden to the books of the law, the Pentateuch. The Samaritans refused to worship in Jerusalem. The Samaritans preferred their own temple. They wouldn't go anywhere else. But when the Jews burned this temple back in 128 years before Christ, the relations got even worse. And now all of a sudden, Jesus, the Son of God, is sitting at the well with a Samaritan woman. He's talking to her, he's communicating with her, and he's asking her for water. What a breach of social customs. But it just didn't stop there. She was, the Bible tells us, a person of no morals. She was an immoral person. And we see the questions that Jesus asked her. He asked her about the husband, and then he told her, you know, the fact is, you've had five husbands, and the man that you now have is not your husband. And we know that she arrived at the well in the sixth hour. And that is out of the social norm. The women drew water in the morning and in the evening. So why would a woman be at the well at high noon, so to speak, in the middle of the heat? Because socially, she was rejected by the people. Socially, she was looked down on as immoral. Maybe it was her shame and her life had separated her from most of the people. And Jesus was talking to her. Jesus not only went out of his way, but Jesus was waiting on her for this specific encounter. You know, if you go back to John chapter 3, we find Brother Allen's favorite story, the story of Nicodemus. And when you really, when you look at the conversion, the salvation of Nicodemus, and you look at the salvation of the Samaritan woman, we see two different instances here that we can take a hold of. You see, Nicodemus, he was a ruler. He was a Pharisee. He was educated. He was very smart. He was probably a rich man, so to speak. He was very successful in life, and he was admired, and he was looked up to. Nicodemus is a picture, or he's an example of the truth that no one can rise so high as to be above the need of salvation. But then in John chapter 4, we see the picture of the immoral woman at the well. And God turned right around after he showed us that picture of Nicodemus, and he also said, there's no person on earth that can sink so low as to be below the need of salvation. You see, John chapter 3, along with John chapter 4, is a picture for every living human being that has ever lived on the face of the earth. To understand, no matter where we're at in the context of our life, no matter how much money we've got, no matter how much worth we have, no matter how much sin we have committed or we're currently committing, there's not a single person that is above the need of salvation or below the need of salvation. That means each and every one of us are in that spectrum of being a lost sinner, separated from God, without the shed blood of Jesus being applied to our life. And Nicodemus and Samaritan woman, they both had an encounter with God. Jesus had to go through Samaria. Why? Well, if you look geographically, it wasn't the shortest route. It wasn't the straight line. He went through Samaria for one reason. He knew there would be an opportunity for him to demonstrate he was the Savior of the world. He knew that there was a person that would need to hear and that would need to know him as Savior. He knew that there was rich men, rich women, poor men, that needed to hear the message of Christ. Before we go to the next point, I want to lay the foundation of how this applies to us. The Bible makes it very clear to us that for all this sin, we come short of the glory of God. It makes it clear to us that there is none righteous, no, not one. And from the fall of man in Genesis, when Adam and Eve, they partook of the fruit and sin became known to them, and they knew good from evil, and they found themselves naked, they found themselves separated, and God had to come before them, and they were ashamed, and they got cast out of the garden, and they were separated from the presence of God. And all men, all women, all boys, all girls have been born from that point on in sin, and the Bible makes it clear we're all sinners. You realize that each and every one of us has an encounter just like Nicodemus and the Samaritan woman. If you've not had an encounter this morning, I'll tell you right now, you will before the morning's over. Because you're going to hear a full presentation of the gospel. Because God is going to have the opportunity to knock at the door of your heart, and you're going to have the opportunity to accept him or reject him. So maybe it be that there be somebody here this morning that God has planned this encounter. Not between me and you, not between anybody else in this room and you, but between God and his word and your heart. But for those who are here and know Christ as their Savior, those who have accepted him, those who have confessed and believed with their heart, you understand that God has left us the responsibility to carry forth his word. God has left us the responsibility to share the love of Christ with those around us. God, Jesus himself, when he died on the cross and he was buried, he was placed in the tomb, he resurrected, when he ascended, he left individual Christians the responsibility to carry forth the encounters that he left us in his word. So for someone who is here today as a Christian, for somebody that's here today and know Christ as their Savior, and maybe we're not looking for opportunities to encounter people and share the message of Christ, maybe that's where God's going to speak to us this morning. Because the truth is, It don't matter how good we are. It don't matter how much we make people smile. It don't matter how many meetings that we meet in people's lives. If we don't share with them the most important message that they could ever hear, and they receive, or they do not receive Christ as their Savior, they're going to hell for all eternity to pay for their sins, separated from God. How much do we really love people? Jesus loved this woman enough that he veered from his normal path, that he broke the social customs of the day just to sit down and share the good news of Christ with an individual. Do we love people that much? Do we look for encounters that God has placed in our life? If not, we should. After the encounter in verses number 10 through 26, we see the offer. The offer. And it's simple. Jesus answered her, "If you knew of the gift that God has made available for you, if you knew of the gift of who it is that's asking you for a drink, you would ask and he would have given you living water." I'm not asking for the water that you can dip your bucket and pull out of that well. I'm telling you that there is a fountain that will never run dry. There is a fountain that will spring up from the depths of eternity. There is a fountain that will flow forevermore. And it is a living water that you can receive, that you can know that Christ is your Savior. Jesus answered to her in verse 13 and 14, "Whoever drinks of this water will be thirsty. Oh, but he who drinks or she who drinks of the water that I can give, you will never, ever thirst again." What an offer. I don't know about you all, but if we take this a little bit out of context for a minute, just to build an illustration in our head. I don't really enjoy getting a cup and getting ice and getting water and sitting down and drinking it and then putting the cup on the counter for my wife to do the dishes. I got it right this weekend. Every now and then I'll rinse it out, but she mainly takes care of that. How good would it be if we were thirsty that we never thirsted again? That's what Jesus is promising. You're going to have wants and you're going to have desires and you're going to have needs in your life, but if you give yourself to Christ, you won't truly have another need. Why? Because I'm offering you eternity. I'm offering you a redemption, so to speak, from this forsaken world, from the troubles and the trials that we have down here. The Samaritan woman thought Jesus was talking about literally a river or a stream that was running and flowing. But he wasn't. He was talking about the living water. Salvation from sin's bondage. Salvation from sin's condemnation. That's what Jesus was offering her. There are many similarities between water and the gift of God's salvation. Do you understand today that the physical water on the face of this earth is absolutely necessary to the existence of life? Your body is primarily made up of water. And you can go without food a pretty long time, but your body cannot go without water near as long. It's essential for life. Salvation is essential for life. You see, if you live to be 140 years old on this earth, that's a long time. But it's nothing compared to eternity. Life, it can only be enjoyed through salvation, because that's eternity in heaven versus eternity in hell. Water on this earth is a gift from above. It's a gift from above. God created the water. He created everything that we have. And God has blessed us with water. Think about our salvation. The living water is nothing less than a gift from above, right? When God sat up there and he looked down and he saw the need of man, he saw the need of you and I, salvation could only come from him. There's no other that were worthy. There's no other that would qualify to meet that need in the individual's life. But God loved us so much, he sent his only begotten Son to die and to shed his blood for our sins. Water refreshes us. Water on this earth satisfies us. Well, that's what salvation does to the sinner. You you can be refreshed, you can be satisfied. But there is a difference. We looked at three similarities. Let's look at the difference. Earthly water satisfies temporary. Short term. Forget a little while. And then it becomes vanity and it passes away. But salvation, it is a permanent satisfaction. It is a permanent quenching of your thirst. It is a changing of your soul and your demeanor and your way. The living water is truly the running stream of life. Jesus Christ is that living water. That's the offer Jesus made to the Samaritan woman. He shouldn't have been talking to her, culturally speaking. He shouldn't even have been in that location, geographically speaking. But Jesus loved her enough that he went to the well and he broke the social customs to offer her the salvation. The last thing we see is the change that took place. Verses 27 to 30 and then verses 39 to 42. First, she made a confession of faith. When she was faced with the fact that Jesus was the Son of God, when Jesus was the Messiah, that Jesus was the Savior, she followed the example that we use today to receive salvation. Romans 10, verses 9 and 10. She confessed with her mouth that Jesus is Lord. She believed in her heart that God had raised him from the dead. The Bible says, thou shalt be saved. Verse 10 tells us it's from the heart that you believe and are justified. It is from your mouth that you confess and that you're saved. You see, that woman at the well that day, she laid her pots down. She laid what she had down, and she ran back to town to tell the people what Jesus had done for her. Come see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Christ? They came out of the town and they made their way toward him. She became a changed person. She not only made a confession of faith, but she experienced a change in her life, a change in her morals, a change in her values. She left the water jar behind her. There's an importance of that. We'll get to it in a minute. But she found the water that satisfied the soul. She found the newness of life that Paul and other apostles had talked about. She found the change that only Jesus could make in her life. She not only confessed, but she not only changed, but she demonstrated a concern for the lostness of others. She ran back and she began to tell others about Jesus Christ. Look at the last verse that we read. Actually, we'll go back to 39. And many of the Samaritans of that city believed on him for the sayings of the woman which testified. He told me all that I ever did. You see, salvation to her was not enough that she had received it. She understood Jesus died for all. She understood that Jesus was going to die for all. We understand today Jesus had died for all. But she understood that the message was for all people. And she ran and she carried that message to others. How do we apply that today? As we're closing. How do we apply it? Are we looking for encounters to share the Word of God and the message of Jesus with other people? Jesus did. We should too. Are we offering what Jesus offered? And that was the message of the gospel. You know, Jesus could have simply spoke to her, took her water bucket, dipped it down in the well, done the labor for her, carried the water back to where she was going, and went. What would that have done for her? Probably nothing. They again, I'm not standing up here talking about Christians doing good works for others, but it's sharing the message of Jesus Christ is going to make a difference in people's lives. Not just serving them and not just living a good life before them. When Jesus told her, I've got water that will never thirst again. I am the Messiah. I am the Christ. If you will accept me as your Savior, I'll change your life. The change took place. It's good to do that. It's great to help people in their time of need. But if a Christian truly is concerned about the lostness of others, first and foremost, we'll share the gospel message with those around us. And then we'll allow our actions to back that message up. We've got that out of context today so many times. So many places that we've got that out of context. We think that just living a good life before people is going to make a world of difference. Well, I'll be honest with you. And I'm just going to lay it out there. I'm not judging anybody. I'm a sinner saved by grace. And I'm still sinning. And I'm working to not. And I'll continue to the day I die. But how's that working for us? How's it working for us? These are cold, hard numbers right here. The majority of people that are a part of this church, we're servants. We'll do anything in the world for anybody around us that we can do. And we're doing a pretty good job of it. Do you know we've not baptized anybody in the last year? Not one. We've got a few coming up, hallelujah. How's our action working? We're not seeing souls come to the Christ. We got to tell people the message of Christ and allow our lives to back up that message. Jesus did. He could have served them. He could have stepped the water, but he shared the message. Even Nicodemus, what did he do, Brother Allen? He answered the question. What must I do to be saved? Nicodemus said. And what did Jesus say? You've got to believe in me. You have to trust me. What are we doing to share the offer with others? The offer that should be first and foremost in our life today is the message of Jesus Christ. And are we seeing a change in people? That's a question. The Bible says that you'll know them by their fruits. The Bible says that God's people will stick out. Because they'll be like a fruit tree that is blossoming with fruit. There's a lot of people today that their fruit is bad. I'm not standing before you and telling them that they've not received Christ as their Savior. That's between them and God. But what I'm telling you is the Bible says you shall know them by the fruit. You shall know them by the way God manifests himself through their life. Is there a change? Is there something that we need to change today, Christian, to better serve those around us, to follow through with the message that God has given us? Only God can satisfy our deepest longings. If you go back to the book of Jeremiah, the prophet said the people have committed two sins. Jeremiah chapter 2, and I think it's verse number 13 or 14. He said there's two sins that God's people have committed against him. First, they have forsaken God, the spring of the living water. Second, they dug their own cisterns. They done things their own way, and their cisterns were broken and they can't even hold water. Well, church, have we forsaken God this morning? Have we began to dig our own systems? Have we began to do things the way we want to do it instead of the way God designed it to be done? If so, we have to be careful that our systems are not broken, because a broken system cannot hold water. What is it that God has in our life? He's got something that he's ready to do for each and every one of us. But I promise you today, these three points apply to each one of us. If you're not saved today, if you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, I believe that today could be the day of encountering. presented the message before you that God has presented, that all people have sinned, that He loved us enough to pay the price for our sin, that you would just receive Him. Confess with your mouth, believe with your heart, God of gracious, and then thou shalt be saved. But for those that are a Christian, God's got an encounter planned for you today, or in the days to come, for you to meet somebody that needs to hear that message. Might be at school, might be at work, might be at Walmart, might be on the side of the road. You and God will know if you'll follow His will. The offer, God's offering His salvation. That's it. The message of the goodness of our Lord and Savior. And if you're here and God has an encounter for you to share the message with somebody else, offer the love of Jesus. Offer the message of salvation. Offer the gospel message. For it is what will change their life. And then there's the change. There'll be confessions, there'll be change, and there'll be concern. God satisfies our deepest longing. God satisfies everybody's thirst for purpose. God satisfies everybody's thirst for hope. And God satisfies everybody's thirst for peace. These three things we need, and I'd say most of us pray for them on a daily basis, for ourselves and those around us. We just want to have a purpose in life. We just want to have hope in life. We just want to have peace in life. One of the last verses in the Bible, Revelation chapter 22, verse number 17, says, "Whoever is thirsty, let him come. Whoever wishes, let him take the free gift of salvation." The free gift of the water. Jesus met the Samaritan woman at the well. Jesus broke the social norm to share the message with her. Jesus went out of His way. Jesus put aside what man would think, and He shared the gospel message and made a difference in somebody's life. Christian, are you willing to do that today? It's a simple challenge. Or if you're here, as we close, and you don't know Christ as your Savior, do you realize that Jesus has done for you just exactly what He done for this Samaritan woman? There's none of us above in need of salvation. There's none of us below being able to receive it. He died for all people. And He's made that salvation so that you can pray with Him. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You for the day. We thank You for everything. Lord, we thank You for this message. I know it's a long passage, Lord. I know it's a passage that's familiar to the majority of us, Lord. God, it's a passage that You laid before us. And God, we are ever so thankful today that You loved us enough that You sent Your Son to die on the cross. That You sent Your Son to endure the agony and the torment, to carry the weight, the sin weight of the entire world upon His shoulders so that He could shed His perfect and sinless blood to pay for our sin. God, we thank You for the salvation that You've given us. We thank You for allowing us to be brought back to good terms with You. But God, You give each and every one of us free will. You give us our own decision, Lord, that we can accept You or we can reject You. God, it's not Your will that anybody spend eternity in hell. God, it's not Your will that anybody be separated from You. But God, sin done that to us because we allowed it to be a part of our life. But God, if You told us, we'll just confess with our mouth, believe with our heart, thou shalt be saved. For whosoever, Lord, You said, to call upon the name of the Lord, shall be saved. God, if there's anyone here today in this time of invitation that does not know for sure that they know You as their Savior, I pray that You just allow them to get that settled for us firmly today. We thank You for the souls that we see saved, Lord. But God, I pray that You remind the rest of us that just like You walked on this earth and You've done these things and You've had these encounters and You made the offering and You give the change, Lord, You have left us as the church and as Christians a responsibility to encounter other people, to give them the same offer that You offered, and that is the love of Christ. cross of Calvary. Dear God, I just pray that you will allow us to be able to step back and watch you change lives. The word that we read today, we're told us that the field is ripe to harvest. And we thank you for giving us a community that we can serve in. And God, I just pray that you allow us to reach out to serve those others. And God, while we serve them with action, may we first and foremost serve them by mouth, where we tell them how much you love them and what you've done for them on the cross of Calvary, and then allow our actions to back up our words. And God, just be guided. If there be anything else in a hard time, maybe we need to pray for someone in our family. Maybe we need to pray for friends. Maybe we need to pray for someone that's a part of this church that we're not sure or we know that they don't know Christ as a Savior. God, just allow us to be concerned enough, just as Samaritan woman was, to pray for them and to go back and tell them. Lord, just convict us and show us where we could better serve you. Lead, guide, and direct us.